we had a 44% turnout in that election, which blew away the turnout for the general election in November. That is incredible. And the 65.8% yes votes that came in to pass that bond was the highest percentage ever for a bond or levy in this district. So thank you for the support. Construction funds include the planning, site design, permitting, and construction, the ultimate construction of the middle school. The property location. So I'm going to describe it to you. I will tell you online there's this video. If you didn't see it during the bond campaign, it's a video I made in the pouring rain out here on that development over here on top of the hill that we all see when we drive into town, the freeway. You look over and you go, oh, the center's growing. You can see that. So the video is on our home webpage if you want to go look at it. The only reason, if you really don't know where the property is, it's great. It gives you the aerial view and it zeroes in, you can see it. So if you haven't been there yet, it's out Lockwood, just east of the what I call the post office development, which was the one that was in about 2002, I want to say, when that went in. So it's just east of that, on the south side of Lockwood. But those of you who have been there a long time, like I have, it's the old chicken farm. So, the barn's gone, the chickens are gone, probably some other stuff left, but we'll clean that up, okay? There is a 4x8-foot sign out in the field that says home of your new middle school. So, if you're driving out Lockwood or coming into town, it's on the south side there. If you go view the video, it will also give you the aerial view of that. And I will add, since Crowdy family sold that to the school district for 50% off the actual appraised value of what that property could have been sold to for developers. So if you know the Crowdy's in town, if you ever run into Mr. and Mrs. Crowdy, who graduated here, by the way, in 1957, they did the school district and our taxpayers a huge favor to sell that to the district for the price they did. So if you ever run across them in town, please say thank you. So middle school construction roadmap and timeline. And by the way, I may turn, I thought here in the audience, Keith Bloom, who's sitting right here in the front, and Kurt Pulowski, they are both, they work for the ESD, they are construction consultants, that's what they do for a living for the ESD. They monitor, help school districts with this process, as you would imagine. School districts don't do this very often. I build my own house, I can't build no school. I can't build the least thing about. Kids would not want to go to the middle school that I built, okay? So the point being, though, that we are going to do this in a professional manner with good oversight and good input and make sure we've got the right people looking at this project throughout. They've already been here twice in the last 2 weeks since the bond passed, and very exciting because of those of you, if you're aware of what's going on in our community and our country right now, there's a lot of stuff being built, and architects and construction firms and tradespeople are at the premium right now, which is good and bad for what we're trying to get done. So we'll be choosing an architect over the next couple of months. We'll be getting through that process of having them submit plans. We'll go through a process that makes sure we find somebody that fits who the center is. And when I say that, I mean, we're not the average school district. You know, all the stuff you just heard Carol talking about, how we do things in this community, is not the way things are typically done in a lot of other communities. To steal the former superintendent's spiel, you know, we like to do things thrifty, not cheap. We also like to do things in a manner that lasts a long time, and we take care of our things, because history has told us in this district, we don't want to make new things. It's kind of like your kid at Christmas. Christmas next year won't be as good. But I think one of the good things about this district is the administration has just been here a long time in various roles. We've got board members that have been here for, I want to say, Chris has been here almost 20 years now. Board. I mean, we've had a history of long service on our school board. It goes through. Because of that, we've got really good institutional memory, and that also lends itself then to making sure we don't make the same mistake twice. And we'll manage it. Those of us that go through this. One of the things we know in this community is that, at least what we've learned, unless I hear things differently during this whole process, is that, again, we will build something that's efficient and that looks nice, that's cost effective, we can be proud of, but it won't be over the top, it won't be elaborate, it won't be one of those things that, you know, people point at and go, oh my gosh, you know, look at the school builds. You can go down to Vancouver School District and see some of those. yeah, they didn't build those. once you choose an architect, you go through a pre-design phase. And what that means is we talk to them about the generalities of what we want. You know, so two stories or one stories or rounds and squares, you know, just the basics of how large are the common area spaces? How large are the libraries? How large is the gym? How wide are the hallways? Do we have lockers or no lockers? If we have lockers, are they above each other or full length? Are they, I mean, just all these different things. Your science lab, is the science lab connected to what? Do we have a technology lab or do we not? Just kind of those things. What does the educational plan look like that we feed into that process when the architect goes away and does a pre-design? Back with multiple ideas of here's an idea, look at this, what do you like about this, what do you like about that, what don't you like about this, and then they can take those things and get a better idea to start detailing it down to something that we may even look at and go, this looks good, this makes sense to us. Once they get to that point, then you go through which would be then that schematic design phase. Design development, these are all just processes they go through to continually take something that's very abstract and define it down to the point where they're ready to start doing actual construction plans of that building. So one of the things we're going to do in this process is we will bring in, once those construction plans start to be developed, we'll have a local group of tradesmen, women, tradespersons, we'll say that. And we'll take a look on a regular basis at the plans that are being developed and look at them from the perspective of what types of materials are being used, what types of design components and building techniques are going to be used that the architect is putting into plans. Because we want somebody, again, that represents us, that knows those things about the trades, that build things on a daily basis and can look at something and say, you know, that brick is really, really nice looking, but I've worked with that brick, and it's really, really hard to work with. And I think if you maybe spec this brick, we can save 5% of construction costs. And when we're looking at these plumbing, the plumbing pieces over here, instead of using, whatever it's Wurzbo, we would spec this because it has the same functionality, but it's maybe 15% more expensive, but you're going to save 30% of labor on install. So we have the people that are going to be able to give us those kinds of feedback to work with that architect before we send plans out to be bid by somebody in construction. Because once the construction bid comes in and you sign that document, you're done, and you suffer the consequences or reap the rewards of all that work that was done ahead of time. So they'll take a look at that process. Then we go through what's called efficiency design.
Value
engineering. Lori has reminded me of that term about six times in the last 2 weeks. I've got some mental block about value engineering. So that is a typical process where, again, the completed plans, before they are sent out to bid, have a different set of architects and engineers look at those plans and give us a list of things about what Gay Long would say. If you change this, you can save this many dollars. If you use this instead of this, you can save this many dollars. If you do this instead of this, you can save this. So it'll be a whole list of items that we can delete or modify to save dollars.
And may I ask?
Yes.
We will often throw in, if we do this, it's going to cost more initially, but it'll bring your service costs down. So it's
And what I would say to that is, we don't go through that list and just go, great, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. Because usually every one of those value engineering ideas has another alternative cost to it over here. Meaning it might be something you really wanted. So you're not going to get rid of it, you just realize, we know he said we're going to keep that. So once we go through that value engineering process and we get that back, then we bring the tradespeople back again and we have them look at that again and say, give us an idea of what this really means here in terms of your perspective on the value engineering suggestions. So again, the people that are on, that do this for a living day after day, can look at that and go, yeah, that makes a lot of sense. No, you don't want to do that. As Mr. Bloom said, because, yeah, that's a great savings right now. You're going to save $20,000, but you're going to repair that roof every 5 years for the next 30. Those kind of things. There's always some give and take on that. So what I'm trying to say in this process, so you understand, is we're going to take this very seriously, and we're going to include local skill to be involved in this, and not just, as good as Mr. Blasky, Mr. Bloom are, it's not that we don't trust them. We want what they're doing to be verified as well for us, so that this is a team approach, and we're not going to trust any one person, any one company, or any one process to make sure we're doing the right thing. We're going to make sure we come with this. So then the goal would be that in the spring of 2019, now I know that sounds crazy, but by the time we got through all of that process, we're probably, hopefully, early spring, maybe this time in a year from now, where we're going out for the actual bid for the contract. Late spring and then summer of 2019, construction begins. And obviously what we're trying to do is line that up, because as you all know, nobody's really building anything right now. We've got the ground has to dry out a little bit. We've got to get a little bit of change in the weather. But whenever that happens, in the spring, early summer of 19, we want to make sure we're hitting the ground running with construction, which then leads to summer of 2020 is the earliest initial occupancy, and fall of 2020 is the earliest possible school opening, which is exactly what we said, 18 months ago when we were talking about this process. So that's the goal. We hope we can beat that, but I'm going to tell you we're going to under-promise and over-deliver another center trait that we hope to stick to in this process. Again, I only put this up here just so you can get a sense of what this process looks like. I know you really can't see this well here in the back. You need binoculars on if you can see this, but the list on the left, are all duties and things that have to be done, performed, and completed. And if you see this middle column, which is right here, I could read that off. It says one day, 11 days, one day, 3 days, 6 days, 6 weeks, 6 weeks, 7 days, 5 days. So those are all duties and tasks that have to be accomplished by the district during this process, the things that have to be done. And I'm putting that up
other, and then on the right, those are, those represent lengths of time. And this is actually 6 pages long. This is just the first process. The first 35 things will go through 4/15. So this is just the duties till April 19th. They're going to 19th. Which, again, is the point when construction would actually start. So, so decisions, specific number and class and size of the classrooms, building safety features, technology infrastructure, common spaces, playfield design, overall classroom design, philosophy, ed specs. So let me just, a couple of things we touched on. Obviously, the portals, right? Somebody asked, are those portals ever going to go away? Let's hope. If you look at the projections that we all shared, that we had professionally done about the growth the city and the school district were likely to see, which was anywhere from 300 to 800 students the next 3 to 5 years, this building with 81,000 square feet will house approximately 450 students. So by the time it opens, we theoretically will be able to pull every student out of the portal and have them inside the building. But at that point forward, then for the next couple of years, it's likely that we'll start rebuilding portals. So where the rubber hits the road is no portals ever finally go away until our community quits growing. Because the other process, which I haven't explained a lot, I touched on it here at some of our community meetings, I'm watching my time here, is that we are doing this without state aid assistance. So sometimes, like if you look at the last bond the Ridgefield School District passed, I don't know what the percentages are, but they're getting a few million dollars to help purchase their school building. When we built this addition in 2004, that actual addition was built by the state with matching funds from the money that the taxpayers passed a bond to do the K campus renovation and did all that enhancement. So there was a match, and I want to say it was about 35% back then, maybe 40%, somewhere in that area. So we passed it on for X number of dollars, that did that, and then the 35 or 40% match, we used that to build this. Okay? So where we were at this time was because we did that in 2004, and there's such a huge demand across the state for new schools and construction, that even though we qualify, because of all those kids we have in portals, we qualify for a huge percentage of state match. But because we used the last one in 2004, we're way down here on the list. So we started going through the process, and what we found about 5-6 months ago, before the board finally decided what they were going to place on the ballot, what the value is going to be, is that on $48 million, we would have gotten $700,000 from the state in matching funds. $700,000 is a lot of money in that perspective. If we took the $700,000 for that project, we would have went clear to the bottom of the list again. And in 3 to 5 years, where I think we're likely going to have to run another bond to build the final wing on a high school to meet that growth, we would have gotten nothing in matching funds. Theoretically, based on the way it has worked historically, wait for 3 to 5 more years, and the huge growth that's going through those construction projects are used up across the state, we will move up the list, and the amount of money we will qualify for matching funds to build that piece will be way, way higher than the $700,000 we have got now. So it's kind of like putting money in the bank, so to speak. You're holding on to an asset. That matching fund is an asset. But if you use it, it goes away. If you save it, it grows. And so that's the plan for this piece. So the portables, there are some of them that need to go away, quite honestly. I mean, they are in a state of repair. They're 25, 30 years old. They need new roofs. The ramps are rotting. The skirting needs replaced. They quite honestly need to go away. We'll obviously very systematically take a look at which ones we can do away with and do that as possible. even though I live up here on the hill, once a week I drive, like, usually during lunch, I'll take my sandwich, and I drive around all these developments and just take a look at what the status is in terms of what's been completed, what's been broken ground, what it's looking like. And I did that just today, and what I found was they're still building. Those of you who go through town, you know, there's four new duplexes right out here on Old Pacific Highway going in. Three brand new families that I counted up the lower portion of the site of up the Airport Heritage Loop. I don't know if I can remember what they call that development, but the mayor probably not trying to put it on this.
Dana
Heights. Yeah. started right now, it started about a month ago, is moving toward being a STEM district, K-12 STEM district, and so that's why that's down there. I'm going to take a real quick opportunity, because I have about 7-8 minutes before I'll get to some questions if you have any. STEM, as you know, stands for science, technology, engineering, and math. You might have heard that. That's changed dramatically over the last 5 to 10 years in terms of what that really represents. It still does mean science, technology, engineering, and math, but it's also a set of learning standards for students that actually goes well beyond those four areas, and it talks about doing project-based learning, hands-on learning, and teaching kids how to think and be logical. So because it, you know, it does still include science, technology, and math, but it also can be applied to history and art and ELA, English Language Arts, and you could have student learning objectives and environments where students are doing work that not only has them learn things of, you know, art learning objectives, but the STEM objectives laid over the top. So it's like a twofer. And I think in this day and age where our students, or we're tasked with preparing our students for jobs in the 21st century, they need those skills. I'd love to talk, any parent wants to talk to me about what they learned in U.S. history in 1980, whatever, and compare that to what we do today. I'd love to talk to you about that whole spiel that I do about how we've changed what we do and what your students learn and why that's important. So, dude, give me a call. I'd love to have a spiel. Questions? Anything I haven't covered, I know it's not for a long time. I'm sorry. Somebody told me I seriously, any questions you have about construction of the school or thoughts, and if you don't have them now, please do call, send me an email, whatever you want to do when things come to mind. Again, going off of what Carol said, just keep communicating, don't hold yourself. Yes.
Would you consider maybe something on
that? That would be up to the board. Do you know anybody on the board? Okay. I'm giving you a hard time. Todd Jones is your husband. Yes, I did that.
I
okay. And that is, there certainly is a possibility of moving that down. It creates a lot of educational challenges because the certification of teachers through the state, that doesn't cross over well. We have a lot of K-8 certifications that teach K-8 campus, and they are certified to teach ninth graders. And so it becomes a bit of a challenge in terms of that. So there's other issues with that. Primarily, probably would be 15-year-old boys and probably 12-year-old girls, you know, which is the same thing talking about bringing eighth graders up here to the high school, you know, to East Grove. We had that conversation earlier too, you know, kindergarten to the high school, is that a solution short term? Bringing eighth graders up, is that a solution? And there's all these other kind of things that go with it. It's, you know, that's a great idea to go, oh, man. There are some other things. So the simple answer to your question is it hasn't been decided. And this is... Okay.
Okay, my computer battery doesn't last that long.